welcome to the 383rd edition of The Business of Story. The show FeedSpot named as the number one business storytelling podcast for 2022. We're a 7-year overnight success, and I'm your host, Park Howell. I'm so happy you're here because today you'll learn about a new storytelling measurement tool I call an emotional EKG that monitors how your audience physically experiences your stories. Are they an active participant enjoying the highs and lows in your storytelling, or are they flatlining with your content? You'll learn how to overcome that on today's Business of Story. But if you want a spike in engagement immediately with every audience, there's only one thing to do. Focus all of your brand, business, leadership, sales, and marketing storytelling with the ABT Agile Narrative Framework.
You know, we all have to communicate. We all have to write for a living and do things to persuade other people. But we often lack the tools to be able to do that. And we have so many opportunities to go down these rabbit holes and get lost and forget what direction we're going, you know, with our writing. And it ends up to be a mess. That's why we need a really great framework. And I've loved the ABT for that. It helps me go back to that primal moment where I remember that a story has to be all about, aha, right? Get to that aha moment. And there's no better way, I think, to really kind of, especially for folks who have trouble focusing and concentrating and, you know, have so many thoughts like I do, get back to that framework and use the ABT.
To me, the most interesting part is the but. I think we're always looking for research that sets up tension in a way that can kind of grab people and maybe surprise them. So I love that idea of kind of establishing a shared vision, demonstrating maybe an obstacle or a contradiction, and then showing how you could help them pave a path forward. I love it.
Found the ABT and how simple it was and how applicable it was. It completely changed the game for me, right? I heard Park Howell on one of Christopher Lockhead's podcasts, and it immediately made sense to me. Read his book, Narrative Gym for Business, and immediately started practicing it. And I've been able to implement story now into social media posts, texts, emails, conversation, and it's just greatly increased my ability to communicate and persuade for the things that I really, really care about. And it's turned me into this guy that's always recommending the ABT and that book to everybody, which then feeds this like feedback loop of people asking me for advice on their ABT, which gets me practicing my ABT more and more often. And it's made me a great storyteller and persuader. So I couldn't recommend it any higher. It's a phenomenal framework, great book, and Park Howell's work is just something that I follow closely.
Visit businessofstory.com/ABT right now and take your storytelling to new heights as you captivate audiences, increase their heart rate, get them all sweaty and goosebumpy about your offering, and ultimately excite them to action. And it all starts with the and, but, therefore, Agile Narrative Framework at businessofstory.com/ABT. But how do you know the ABT works, let alone your storytelling in general? You know, you're getting a lot of thumbs ups and likes and smiling emojis, but are they translating into sales? And by sales, I mean anything that you are trying to get your audience to buy into, including your product or service offering, your vision, your mission, your way of doing things. Well, today's guest believes he has an answer using a Fitbit, iPhone, or any digital device that monitors your nervous system.
If I give you a message or a story or an experience, how do I know that's a great experience for you? Again, I could ask you, but we know that liking poorly predicts outcomes. If liking worked, 8% of movies in Hollywood for the past 30 years wouldn't have lost money. If liking works, every marketing campaign would be successful, right? So I think liking is the wrong thing to ask people. That's a conscious appraisal of an unconscious emotional response that we care about. And so we can get to that unconscious emotional response with technology.
Dr. Paul Zak is a professor at Claremont Graduate University and is in the top 3% of most cited scientists. A 4-time tech entrepreneur, his most recent company, Immersion Neuroscience, is a software platform that allows anyone to measure what the brain loves in real time to improve outcomes in entertainment, education and training, advertising, and live events. He is a regular TED speaker and has appeared on Good Morning America, Dr. Phil, Fox & Friends, ABC Evening News, with his work being covered by the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, USA Today, Time Magazine, The Economist, Scientific America, Fast Company, Forbes, and many others. Paul is the author of The Moral Molecule, The Source of Love and Prosperity, and his new book, Immersion, The Science of the Extraordinary and the Source of Happiness. Today, you'll learn how the Immersion SaaS platform works, who's using it to test the emotional effectiveness of movie trailers, to sales presentations, to TV commercials, even podcasts. Paul shares his five-step approach to creating extraordinary experiences with your storytelling and how to measure your success. Plus, he explains how he overcame a stinging zinger tossed his way by John Oliver, host of HBO's Last Week Tonight with John Oliver, about his work with oxytocin. All that and plenty more on this special edition of The Business of Story with Dr. Paul Zak. Paul, welcome back to the show.
Thank you, Park. So nice to be back with you.
I don't know if you realize this, but I launched this podcast 7 years ago. And in doing so, the folks that were helping me distribute it said, Park, see if you can get 6 to 8 shows in the can before we launch it so that we've got a little bit of a library going. And you, believe it or not, were kind enough to come on the show and be on episode number 6. And I just remember what an honor that was, because I had seen your 2011 TED Talk on the Moral Molecule. I wrote an article about it and even showed people how to use the story cycle system and how your presentation was presented. And you responded immediately and were so kind and accepted my invite to come on a brand new show. And so for that, I want to thank you after 7 years.
Well, thank you, Park. And we had stayed in touch all these 7 years, which has also been really pleasant. I've enjoyed it.
It's been fun.
And so much new to share with you now. So we really haven't done an update on that. So this will be fun.
Well, you did all that work studying oxytocin. And I'd love to have you, for our listeners who don't know you and know your work, if you could give us a little bit of a backstory about how you got into this whole field of oxytocin, which you coined the moral molecule, and its impacts, of course, on storytelling.
Well, as you know, Park, I'm a Martian, so I don't really understand the humans. And so
you are a professor, so I get that.
Of course. So I run a pretty big behavioral neuroscience lab. And, you know, the bad behavior in humans is sort of easy to study, right? Fear and aggression, because we can induce that pretty easily. But the good behavior is actually kind of hard to study. There wasn't really a way to understand why people, when no one's looking, are nice to each other, help each other out, donate to charity. Where does all this kind of kindness and goodness come from? And my work had shown that trust was among the strongest factors to explain differences in living standards across countries. So rich countries, the Denmarks, the Norways, the Swedens, the U.S., tend to have high levels of trust. So just kind of random strangers. And there's a bunch of reasons for that. But I really want to understand, within a country, within a region, within a shopping center, why would you ever trust anybody that interacted with you? And most animals don't. If I don't recognize you as a member of my family, then you're an aggressor, right? I'm not going to hang out.
And that's a survival instinct, is it not?
Absolutely. So yeah, we've got to be careful, right? So there are benefits from socializing with others, but there's lots of costs. You could steal from me, you could hurt me, right? Lots of things. So how do we understand that balance? And in doing this work, discovered this rich animal literature in oxytocin, and then created a technology, a procedure to measure the human brain's acute production of oxytocin. And then from this, discovered all kinds of interesting things, that oxytocin seems to be, which is a chemical your brain makes, seems to be a very key signal that the person interacting with you appears to be safe or trustworthy. And oxytocin does a couple interesting things. It increases our sense of empathy. So now I'm a much better social creature if I not only understand cognitively why you're doing what you're doing, but have a sense of why you care about it. What's your emotional commitment to what you're doing? It motivates individuals to work on others' behalf. And it actually reduces physiologic stress, that stress we have from being around strangers. And so those three factors make it a really powerful way to understand a number of the kind of good behaviors that we see in the world. And this leads us into story. So as we did this work, we started asking, well, we've measured oxytocin release and can predict people's cooperative behaviors by drawing blood and measuring changes in oxytocin. I wonder if this works at a distance, right? So why would... neurologically, I am fascinated as a Martian that people cry at movies, which I do all the time since I had kids. That's neurologically really, really weird, right? If you're in a theater, you are certainly suspending disbelief, but you're cognitively intact. You're not on drugs. You're aware these are professional actors. You're aware this is probably a fictional story. At the end of the movie, the boy gets the girl and people cry. That's weird, right? That's super weird. So we started investigating storytelling.
It's interesting because you're exactly right. We sit there as a passive audience, but then we are drawn into the story. And our brain, I guess, doesn't really know whether we are an active participant now in that story, but it's playing along. So it's triggering really not even just oxytocin, right? Cortisol and some of the other neurotransmitters.
Exactly right. So we started investigating story as a way to see if we could influence people to engage in particular behaviors. As you know, we're heavily funded by the U.S. Department of Defense and some other agencies to create a test bed to train soldiers to be more effective communicators. And that means more effective storytellers. So I think what's interesting about story is ultimately story is about influence. I want to influence you to care about the environment or to engage in some behavior, or perhaps to buy a product. So we looked at all the different ways to present information. Story is by far the most effective way to keep people immersed in an experience. So immersion is a neurologic state my research uncovered in which people are attentive to the experience, but they're also emotionally resonant with it. It produces this emotional response that tags that experience as important. And when that brain values the experience actually is saved in a very particular way, and it kind of nags you. It says, hey, Park, hey, Park, hey, Park, knock, 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 do this thing, remember this thing, right? So if you think of any extraordinary experience in your life, you know, birth of a child, a wedding, you know, something amazing, 9/11, it could be negative things. Those are top of mind. They're saved. They're highly emotional, so they're saved in very particular ways. So great stories do the same thing. If I can create a great story, not only is it enjoyable, do I get this immediate reaction, but I also get this benefit, which is that is very memorable. And I can very easily bring that story into consciousness through cueing, through hearing the music, smelling the smell, seeing the font. There's all kinds of ways that businesses do this. And so now I've measured 50,000 brains in a variety of experiences, and I'll share at some point during this podcast the 5-step process of influencing people using story.
All right. We're going to do that in just a minute, but something came up several years ago, and I have been dying to ask you about it. And I should have sent you a note and jumped on a call, but I'm going to ask you right now. So your work with oxytocin in your first book, The Moral Molecule, which is a fabulous book, really brought you a lot of attention. I mean, you were on The Bachelor, right? So what can you tell our audience a little bit about what you did on that TV show, The Bachelor, and how you got that?
Right. I think it's, the TED Talk and kind of being in the media Rolodex, because we had developed a tool to assess this large set of good behaviors and published tons of scientific research that if you're a skeptical listener, just go into Google Scholar and put my name in there and you'll find tons of stuff. Yeah, so I think it was interesting that there was interest not only by scholars, but by the general public in, you know, how do we actually understand the people around us? So by knowing the mechanism through which oxytocin is released, we also looked at what inhibits oxytocin release. How similar is it across individuals? So we know, for example, that when people like each other or love each other, their physiologies begin to coordinate. So I release oxytocin when you release oxytocin, right? We're having a great time together. And again, a couple other neurochemicals, including dopamine, is part of this suite that tells us, like, I'm in, I'm immersed, I'm having a ball. So we were asked to be on The Bachelor. We did a show for Valentine's Day and the Today Show. We've been in a whole bunch of interesting cases. Did a interesting BBC show called Dogs versus Cats, which is the better pet. We measured oxytocin release in dogs and cats before and after they played with their owners. Anyway, you can find all these clips online. But I think it is a way to really understand these really unusual behaviors. I got two dogs lying at my feet here. That's super weird. I have two other mammals of a different species living in my house. Again, very unusual animal behavior. Humans are different on that. So the deep question is why? And I think part of that answer, Park, is because around 100,000 years ago, there was a mutation in our brains that just created a proliferation of receptors for oxytocin. So we are extraordinarily sensitive to social information. And then around 10,000 years ago, when this mutation has spread, we see civilizations forming where we can live around strangers. And I think the beautiful thing about that is this hypersensitivity to social information means that stories are a way to transmit information, to influence others, and to create enjoyment because we are fascinated by the other humans. They are doing some crazy stuff. And that's why fictional stories, where I can create an environment and teach people something or show people something, are very compelling to us. And certainly nonfiction can do that as well.
Speaking of another human coming out and being very skeptical, John Oliver on HBO on Last Week Tonight took a shot at you and your work.
To be fair, it's not always the news media. Sometimes researchers themselves will oversimplify the science. Even TED Talks, which have had some amazing speakers, have also featured some morning show style science in the past, like Paul Zak's 2011 talk on a hormone produced in the brain called oxytocin, which he even gave a catchy name to.
This little syringe contains the moral molecule. It's so easy to cause people's brains to release oxytocin. I know how to do it. And my favorite way to do it is, in fact, the easiest. Let me show it to you. Come here, give me a hug. There you go. Here's your prescription from Dr. Love. 8 hugs a day. We have found that people who release more oxytocin are happier. And they're happier because they have better relationships of all types. Dr. Love says 8 hugs a day.
There is no way that I would be happier giving 8 hugs a day. I'm English. That is 4 lifetimes worth of hugs.
And that was the thing that really surprised me is when it came out. I was watching the show and this, like, you know, talked about you and your work. And I'm like, I know that guy. And then he kind of threw it under the bus. And I was wondering, number one, how do you overcome the skeptics? And number two, how did that make you feel?
Yeah, I think this is not very clever humor. To take something out of context. So for my TED talk, so TED is technology, entertainment, and design. It has to be entertaining, storytelling for big people, but go read the goddamn science. Read the, you know, I'm the top 0.3% most cited scientists in the world. Like, it's not like this work has not been vetted over and over and over. The federal government had labs replicate my research. So I think it's a cheap shot to take something you did 10 years ago, Park, and take out a 20-second clip and make fun of it. That's not clever. That's not funny. On the other hand, if you're a public intellectual, I have a public persona. That information's out there. You can do what you want. So, at first it was like, this is not very nice. On the other hand, you know, I'm out in the public, and I think it's a great platform to be able to remind people that humans, even though much of the news is about the bad behavior, most of what happens day to day is amazingly good behavior. People smiling at each other, people being kind, helping others. And that's what social creatures do to keep ourselves embedded in community. We do not survive alone. We need to be embedded with others. And we do that through service. So when I serve my friends, I had this discussion with my daughter last night, who was 19 in college. She asked, what's the meaning of life? That's a real interesting conversation to have. And, you know, I said, part of that is service, right? I think about my friends. I think about my wife. I'm constantly thinking about what I can do to make them happy, right? Because they give me so much joy and pleasure. And to sort of degrade that and talk about blah, blah, blah. So anyway, you know, the scientific method is, can I use one bad word, Park? Am I allowed?
Absolutely.
scientific method is a process to get rid of bullshit, right? Comedy is about creating bullshit, but science is a process that replicates. We share all the data. All this is available. So if it was wrong, the scientists would have found it. But it's, you know, very much been replicated and extended. You know, that TED Talk was in 2011. I think we filmed it in 2010. It came out in 2011. So, you know, science evolved.
You've done a ton of work since then.
Yeah, and that was early days. And the reason I was at TED, because it was early days for oxytocin. So I do think that the new work we're doing on this data called immersion has really kind of put the oxytocin work on steroids and really asked, how do I, as a social creature, how do I have the most impact on others? So I don't believe in feelings. I think, you know, feelings are very vague and fleeting. But if I can predict behavior, that's interesting. So we really worked on the neuroscience of extraordinary experiences, using that information to predict what people do after a message or an experience. And that's where the immersion work came out, which was, again, the extension of the oxytocin work.
Well, and you're right. And HBO's job is to go out there and be disruptive. And you've done a lot of work and you've taken a stand on something. And of course, when anybody ever has the courage to take a stand on anything and then back it up with your science, you can be easy pickings for the comedy shows. But anyways, that was the question I was wondering. How did that go over with you? Thanks for covering that with us. Now let's talk about your work with immersion and what you learned from oxytocin to get you into this, you know, new chapter in your journey and your new book that's out.
Right. Thank you. So the question was, if I give you a message or a story or an experience, how do I know that's a great experience for you? Again, I could ask you, but we know that liking poorly predicts outcomes. If liking worked, 8% of movies in Hollywood for the past 30 years wouldn't have lost money. If liking works, every marketing campaign would be successful, right? So I think liking is the wrong thing to ask people. That's a conscious appraisal of an unconscious emotional response that we care about. And so we can get to that unconscious emotional response with technology. So some years ago, we identified electrical signals associated with this data called immersion, which are attentive, so say with the binding of dopamine, and you're emotionally resonant with the experience, the binding of oxytocin. When those two things occur, it's a very weird neurologic state, but it strongly predicts what people will do. And so our working hypothesis is that if I tell you a story or give you an experience, and then you do something difficult or costly, that must have been sufficiently valuable to your brain that you go, oh, holy crap, I got to do this, right? This is amazing. And so we worked backwards. We gave people a variety of experiences, first measured these neurochemicals in blood, and then measured the electrical activity associated with those neurochemicals at very high frequency. But then finally, as you know, Park, you never want to fight fair. I'm a big believer in fighting unfair. And so we built a software platform 5 years ago that allows us to measure, and our subscribers, to measure immersion in real time by applying algorithms to smartwatch data. So now we have...
All right, can I level set here for a second? Just because, man, you're covering a lot here.
Yeah.
Is it as simple as this for my pea brain that, okay, I've learned how to tell a story, and I'm up in front of a crowd telling a story, or I'm creating a 30-second commercial or a trailer to a movie, and I think I've nailed it because I've used all the proper story structures. I've got specificity in there. I believe I'm triggering the setup problem resolution dynamic. I think I'm kicking some dopamine in, and hopefully some oxytocin is getting released, but I just don't know. And so I lead with, let's call it a 30-second commercial, and I am so proud of it because I've done everything right in my storytelling, and yet it bombs. And we sit around and look at each other and we go, why did it bomb? Is it that you and your technology now can pre-test that commercial in this case and tell us what are the high points, what are the low points? Is it completely flatlining all the way through and what we should accentuate in it? I mean, is that how it basically works?
Exactly. So we've tried to democratize the neuroscience so that anybody can measure what brains love second by second in real time. Any place people are, not in a lab, but any place people are doing cool stuff. So our intuition fails for lots of reasons, not because people are not smart and they're not trying their best, but our measurement device for intuition is flawed, right? If I'm tired or hungry or had a fight with my wife or, I don't know, my dog died, My brain works differently. And so by having others, measuring others' brain responses, we're much more likely to see not only overall, is this an effective way to influence people's attitudes, opinions, behaviors, but how do I create this second by second? So for example, we and our subscribers have shown that when the call to action or the branding moment occurs, it's more likely to be remembered or acted on when it occurs at an immersion peak, right? So I want to have that emotional peak during the call to action. So many times, say in advertisements, we see a nice little story, the story arc resolves, and at the end, it says, buy our thing, or, you know, brought to you by so-and-so. Bad timing, right? So we think, oh, we have to resolve the story arc. Why, right? I want to have as much impact as possible. I want that emotional tagging to go, this thing is important. So I want to link that story to that product or that brand. Now, sometimes you can do that. We've certainly seen, I've seen an immersion for a ton of ads, which are little mini stories, right? Ads are fun to test because they're mini stories in which you have an objective outcome. Did sales move or not?
Some are. 95% of them are just noise being blasted at you. 5% completely. Of them are mini stories, I think.
Now fair
I'm
enough.
Sharing my bias.
No, fair enough. You're right. And so when you see this, oh, I told a story and I generated great emotional growth, right? I have this emotional peak, and then it says, oh, this is the way to continue to have this experience or to follow through, or this is why it's important. And so it's really hard to do. It's hard to structure a story that has, growing tension, but also ends with tension, right? That's asking a lot of the storyteller, but I think that's a measurement problem. It's a structural problem that can be resolved with measurement. How about that?
Well, and you were talking about the challenge of keeping the story loop open. You open the story loop, you build tension, and you immediately go to that call to action. But what happens, Paul, and maybe you can share with why this works, is doesn't our brain, if we don't close the story loop for our audience is going to make up its own ending? Because I've had others on the show that tell me that our brains cannot stand an open story loop. It has to close it so it has finality and moves on. Number one, is there truth to that thought from what others have shared with me? And number two, is that what you're seeing in your measurement is folks out there, you've got to close that story loop before you get to that call to action or make sure that CTA is a part of Act 3 and closes that story arc.
Yeah, I think I'm going to disagree with both those points. So I think when we look at things like successful theatrical movie trailers, those are generally half of the story arc. So they tell you half the story, introduce the characters, put them in a crisis, and then you got to buy a ticket to find out what happens next. I think that can be effective storytelling in all kinds of ways. Now, your brain will guess. The brain loves patterns. So in that sense, brain's going to guess what's going to happen. But one of the ones that we had worked on early on was this movie Fault in Our Stars. It cost $12 million. So it was based on a young adult novel. So it already had a good fan base. $12 million production cost for that movie. It earned $307 million. And the story arc for that is two kids in a, or sorry, the theatrical trailer story arc is two kids in a like support group for kids with cancer. One has like oxygen going to her nose, and then the kids kind of fall in love. And then near the end of that 3-minute trailer, the girl like passes out and they rush her to the hospital. Okay, so holy crap, are they going to get back together? Does she die? One of them's got to die. I mean, you kind of think about that, but you don't know, right? So the trailer was very well produced. They did a couple other things which I think are very interesting. It was a good movie. It was very, really well done, but unknown actors. But they focused on identifying super fans for that. And we see this in very successful storytelling and advertising. Even if it's just average immersion, if you have super fans that love it, they will experience this and share it over and over and over. So for Fault in Our Stars, they had these sort of super screenings where you paid $25 to watch the movie, and then the stars would come in a live feed and answer questions from the audience. So you basically paid twice the price of a regular movie. And so the core demographic for this movie was a teenage woman. And they would show up in groups and go 4, 5, 6, 7 times and post on social media. And, you know, it was a whole thing. So they really, so I think for listeners, you know, think not only about creating that story structure, but who loves this the most? So the term of art in neuroscience is called top-down control. When something is relevant to you, you actually devote more brain processing to that. So that means targeted stories, number one. And then number two, for any story you release, find those super fans and ask them to work for you. They are turned on. They will work for free if you just ask them.
Now, how do you measure this? So you've got them in there. How do you know that this stuff is working? And what is your empirical science that you then give to your customers and clients through your immersion SaaS product? Mm-hmm. How do you get to that, and how reliable is it?
Yeah, so we're able to predict things like sales bump from advertising in the 90% accuracy range very consistently. Information recall correlates with immersion around 0.6, so very strong information recall weeks later. So it seems like immersion is one of the brain's valuation mechanisms for social experiences. Again, when that social experience has enough emotion associated with it, our brain goes, holy crap, this is the best thing ever. So yeah, SaaS products. So we are device agnostic. We can pull data from fitness sensors, Apple watches, Fossil watches, and apply algorithms in the cloud that let us infer brain activity in real time by pulling data from the cranial nerve. So these cranial nerves are kind of the output file. I'm pointing to my neck for people who can't see me. Cranial nerves are sort of the output file of the brain, and those actually pass through the heart. So we're feeding in heart rate. We don't care a thing about that. But these cranial nerves, like third and fourth order changes in the rhythms of the heart. So over many years, Park, you know, wrote algorithms that let us see this brain activity in real time, and then really took these native signals from the brain and convolve them mathematically to maximize predictive accuracy. So this neurologic state called immersion does not exist in nature. It's something that we created from nature to help us create extraordinary experiences, whether recorded, in person, a theater, walking through a museum. You know, we all want extraordinary experiences. As you said, we seldom get them.
Mm-hmm. So if I'm a part of your study, I've got either my Apple Watch.
Not part of a study. You're a subscriber. No, not part of a
or
study.
I'm a subscriber. Okay.
You have brains. You have a piece of software on your desktop, and you have some folks that like your product, or they're in a panel, and you send them an email and say, "Hey, we want to test this new story. We want to test this experience."
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like I'm a test subject, so I'm just wearing my Apple Watch or a Fitbit, and I sit down and watch a trailer to a movie that you were testing for a customer of yours.
Not me.
And I watch it.
I'm not involved. You don't talk to me.
You're
it's
not involved
SaaS.
At all.
It's
okay.
Software. No, you don't talk. I'm a weirdo. I'm a Martian, remember? You don't want to talk to a Martian. I'm messed up, man.
They're phoning you home.
So the software does all
me.
The work for you. You watch the data come in real time. It aggregates it, and it has norms. It has 50,000 brains on there. It tells you, is this good or bad, and how to make it better. Color codes, green, awesome. Red, not so good. Gray, yeah, doing okay. So it's all automated, so you don't need to talk to humans. And then you can test this thing. It's, you know, fixed price. You can test this thing over and over and over. So for the movie trailers, the studios that have used us, they take a bunch of roughs. These companies rough out trailers. They test them. Okay, take the top two, begin to edit them, test them again, take the best one, edit it, right? So it's just an iterative process. So you're getting better and better. And what's interesting is from a story perspective, you can just see in the data these peaks and troughs, right? This is theatrical trailers are 3 minutes. So I can't just have this straight, you know, Freytag triangle going straight up forever. It's got to have a little bit of variation so your brain gets a breather. But then at that peak moment, that's when I want that call to action.
So essentially, you are like an emotional EKG. And you're getting this information from a smartwatch of some sort on a subject's arm as they're watching this trailer. And then the person who uses your software can look at this mapping of the highs and lows of the motion. And is it peaking at the right places? Are we getting the immersion that we want?
Correct.
Just to boil it down to the basic use of it.
Right.
Because that's pretty amazing. And so it goes into the cloud, and then are you using AI and you know, computer learning to bring this together with all of the data that you're getting from all these different subjects and trying to, I don't know, find norms in it?
Yeah, we already have really good norms. And you're right. We're applying machine learning to this. So I'll give you a concrete example of a client use that, suppressing the name of the client, I won't tell you, but a streaming song service said, look, our problem is there are 20,000 new songs released worldwide every day. And we don't know which ones to add to people's playlists. We try to categorize them and suggest, because people want new music, but not too much new music. That's the problem. I like my old music, but I, you know, once in a while I want something new. And so when we had people, like 65 people, listen to these songs that they had never heard before, and then the streaming service gave us the streams and the added to playlist and a bunch of outcome measures 3 months later, the brain knows with 97% accuracy which songs are going to be hits. So the streaming service told us which ones are hits and which ones are misses, and the brain knows. So that's a real useful application, right? It tells you which songs to bring into people's playlists, and it's really effective. So neurologic data are inherently nonlinear, and so these metrics just love machine learning. So you're exactly right. So that's wild, right? And by the way, on self-report, if you ask people, if you like this song, you think it's a hit, zero predictive accuracy. People can't tell because, again, we're filtering that emotional response that music is meant to evoke in us into our conscious appraisal of something that just doesn't predict.
Do people use this for A/B testing where they will have produced two commercials, say 30-second spots, run them through, and how many subjects do they need to have an accurate feedback on which one pulls better than the other?
Wonderful science question. So the data were reliable, statistically reliable when you have 35 people. So you don't need a lot because you're getting such high frequency data, second by second data. So yeah, perfect for A/B testing, perfect to know where to put your marketing dollars, and perfect for crafting great stories, right? To really know. So just as a quick example, pre-COVID, one of the TV networks that you would know was using our technology to assess new shows. So the problem with linear TV, besides the audience disappearing on a weekly basis, is that before each commercial, they lose a proportion of the audience. So they want to make an immersion peak prior to that commercial. Everybody who knows this, this is not new information. Except on the data they collected on people watching new shows, only 40% of the time was an immersion peak prior to a commercial. Even though these are professional storytellers, these are pros, they're in the TV biz, they're not just off the boat, and yet they miss the mark 60% of the time, right? Because they're using intuition, using this flawed measurement technology, and the assumption that if I dig it, other people will too. In some sense, yeah, you got to like what you're doing, you got to be passionate about it, but if your job is to have an impact on others, you've actually got to measure others, right? Not just yourself, because that producer, that director, he or she is different, right? They're specialists. And we know from lots of neuroscience that specialists experience those experiences that they're specialized in quite differently than, non-specialists.
One of my big mantras, Paul, is to don't be an intuitive storyteller, because it means you're winging it most of the time, and to become intentional about it. So use the frameworks that we teach, the ABT, the five primal elements of a short story, and the 10-step story cycle system. It just makes you more effective more often. It's not foolproof. You'll still blow it on occasion, as I have. And so what you are saying is kind of the same thing I'm hearing, and correct me if I'm wrong, that in the past, without this measurement, we were intuitive about what we thought was a good experience, and we would go and ask people what their experience was, knowing that their memories aren't always the best. And we see these likes that we think are really fantastic for us, but maybe are kind of misnomers coming at us. And so you're saying now with your immersion tool that you can actually scientifically study the emotional connection between heart and head. And, you know, we all always say sell to the heart and the head, logical head will follow. But you're saying now that you've got statistically relevant outcomes that people can measure what the actual true impact is on their audience with their storytelling.
Exactly right. So intuition, you know, I call this approach creative plus, by the way. This is not getting rid of creatives. We need people to create stories. As you said, just test and refine. Now we have a framework. You have a process to actually take that rough story and refine it. You know, one of my favorite books, Park, I'm sure it's one of yours too, is Stephen King's book On Writing. And one of the great insights from that book is that the most enjoyable part of storytelling is revisions. And it used to be when I wrote, like, oh my God, revisions. I just want to stop. I said, no, that's when you're polishing. That's when you're making it beautiful. You took this chunk of clay and now you're sculpting and molding it and firing it and putting a glaze on it. And so that's what immersion helps storytellers do is, you know, really efficiently create a high impact story.
Oh, it's fascinating stuff. You've got to be really excited about this because not only did you help define that oxytocin moral molecule, but now you've got even a better way, it sounds like, to measure its impact and the impact of other neurotransmitters on that you are creating in an audience with the stories you tell.
Yeah, and I think we left a little part out, which is oxytocin's not the only thing that motivates behavior. Right. So if I'm trying to predict behavior, individual or market behavior, I also need this dopaminergic attentional response, right? So it turns out that both those are necessary and they have some downstream effects that we can capture. So first thing, it's got to capture my attention, right? So I think, you know, opening hot, our data show that if you don't get people's attention in the first 15 seconds, you're unlikely to ever get it again. Now, there are exceptions.
Like Lisa Cron said in her fabulous book, Wired for Story, she says you have to have a ball in play.
Yeah, exactly.
Just like
right.
you said. And I love that. I think about that all the time. Do I have a ball in play with what I'm talking about right now, right off the bat, to get them?
Yeah. Ocean hot. But also, you know, you've got to create an environment where people can be immersed in that story. So I call this staging, right? So I do want to have a little bit of a setup. This is like in the theater, right? Where we bring the lights down. We ask you to turn your screens off. So I'm preparing you. I'm giving you the neural bandwidth to actually really be immersed in this story. So in my five, I'll give my five-part little algorithm if people want to know it. So first is staging.
Yeah, let's do that. Yep.
Yeah, so first is staging. So give me that psychological safety. Give me that bandwidth to explore the experience. So create a little bit of comfort in this, in the environment people are in.
Give us an example. Is that the physical environment you mean?
That's really the social environment, but it means, you know, if you're busy or angry or a rush, you know, it's not going to be a great experience. You just, because you're burning bandwidth to do other things. So that could be for a video, it could be as simple as starting with a blank screen. It could be as simple as just having something that just gives me 2 seconds to just take a breath, right? Could be a voiceover before I start telling that story, something easy to get me in. So first I'll stage the experience. The second is, again, create an immersive experience. So use that narrative arc, capture attention within 15 seconds, and then have genuine emotions at human scale so that people care about the topic. If it's selling something like a product or service, you need what I call product story congruence. You can't just tell a story and then drop in a logo, buy Diet Coke. Right? Diet Coke's got to be part of the story. It's got to be integrated into the story. The next is this, again, relevance. So that is targeting the story at people who care about it the most, right? So there's not one, maybe there is one universal story. We could have a debate about that. But in terms of the way you present that story, the iconography, the music, some cultural relevance, it's really targeting the story at specific audiences, which is so much easier to do now with the internet. And then finding super fans, finding the people who can really make that story have legs, who are going to share it, and engage those super fans. Give them a little tchotchke, give them a little something, and ask them to help you. They love it. It's part of their life. This is the Fault in Our Stars fans. And then lastly, have that call to action, whether implicit or explicit. It's got to happen at an immersion peak when emotion is high. And if you have a story with multiple emotion peaks, have branding occur or have that implicit call to action occur at mid-story peaks. So concrete example of that, we've done a lot of work with life insurance companies. So life insurance is a poorly differentiated product, all pretty much the same. So we've seen some wonderful life insurance commercials in which it's maybe a 60-second story, but there's an emotional peak at second 30, and then you see a car with the logo of the company, or you see a bag with the logo of the company, right? So that is reinforcing the relationship between the story and the action or the brand. And then the call to action happens at the end, and you can have a second peak if possible. So the acronym for that, by the way, is CIRTA, like certain, S-I-R-T-A, staging, immersion, relevance, target, and action.
Making mad notes here, Paul. Thank you so much for that. And of course, your new book out, Immersion. will take the reader through all that and show them how to do this in their storytelling, really, yeah. I guess, in all messaging.
Yeah, what we've learned in measuring 50,000 brains. So what are the core principles? So you certainly don't need to measure anything to buy the book. The book will give you, here's the sort of general principles for live experiences, for storytelling, for great training and education. But my kids were in Zoom school, and boy, you see, the school is not very, very well organized, not delivered. The content's not delivered well. And so we have a lot of clients in the corporate training and the education space. So we have tons of data on that. And so there's some general principles on how to make that better. By the way, storytelling, participation, right? Participation is very important. And then ultimately, it's about happiness, right? When we create happy story consumers who are also consumers of products and services, we increase customer lifetime value. I dig this company. I dig this product. I like this brand. I'm in, right? And so reinforce that with a story and then give me something to do. Give me a reminder to continue to share the story, to buy the product or service.
Yeah, you know, going back to those teachers in the Zoom training, these poor people were just never taught how to do that. And,
no.
You know, they were thrown into it immediately. And I imagine they've learned quite a bit in that process. And it's changing the face of virtual training and virtual education, whatever. But they would do well to read Immersion and understand, where do I make my points? What are the high points? Where do I take them? You know, a low point in this thing. In some of my presentations, I will have had, and I do it really more off of intuition as well. So I'm eager to try your platform. And, you know, you find a high point, maybe it's in a point that you make, or it's a quick little video clip that gets them laughing. And then sometimes I'll try to pull the rug out from underneath them and have nothing. In fact, the screen goes black. And all I'm trying to do in that virtual reality world is to get them to go, what the hell? What just happened? Now I've really got their attention, and then I can jump in and share with them a point I was trying to make, and they see how it all ties together that way. So I think it's really fascinating to be able to have a program that we could put our work through and see what is really actually working and what's not working. I would assume, do you have customers using your SaaS platform for sales presentations? Because
absolutely.
I would think of anything flat lines, it's a sales presentation when all they're doing is talking about me, 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 SSS, and feature, feature, function, function. Do they like bring in and do presentations and just kind of take the temperature of the crowd there? What was working, the highs and lows of that presentation?
Yeah, almost all the major professional services organizations, I don't want to mention their names, but you know who they are.
Your website, you'll see a lot of them.
I'll use our platform, you know, ones who, I don't know who we signed off to say we can talk about them. Accenture is one of those. They've signed off.
Yeah,
so they'll do, because the data are live, Neuroscience Live is really, really hard because it's got signal extraction, a lot of math involved, but they can see live. You can do that sales presentation to your colleagues and see right away if it works. Okay, that didn't work. Let's try that again. So this is, you know, really storytelling on steroids. So, great. And for listeners, for Business of Story, you can go to our website, getimmersion.com, upload a video, and we'll give you neurologic measurements in 24 hours for free. So just, you know, try it out.
Really?
Yeah.
So I could shoot you over one of my virtual trainings, put my video in there, and then you're going to give me a report back that tells me my highs and lows of it? Based off of all the content that you've gotten already from other folks, and so you can kind of tell what's going to work and what's not going to work?
Exactly right. So really good norms, because we have so many people on the site for all kinds of different experiences, but maximum 3-minute video.
Okay.
Hard to get people to watch for free for too long. So we have a panel of people that sign up who just love our site and will, you know, watch stuff. So, but yeah, why not? Give it a spin.
I will do that, and I will definitely put that link in the show notes. Final question, because you have done so much exhaustive work around oxytocin and what you're doing now with Immersion. Have you ever looked back and thought maybe you shouldn't have called yourself Dr. Love because it sets you up for guys like John Oliver to come after your good work?
Well, I didn't do that. Fast Company gave me that title. So maybe I'm Dr. Immersion now. But I think it's ultimately getting about happiness, but really creating experiences that people love, giving them a sense of joy. So again, you can create a wonderful, I don't know, commercial for Huggies, and I'll enjoy those little babies running around. But if I don't have infants at home, I'm not going to buy Huggies. So there's no brainwashing, there's no undue influence. But still, if we're bringing joy to the world, awesome. And maybe my grandkids need Huggies or something. Who knows?
I'm going to, as a brander myself, I'm going to move you now, evolve you from Dr. Love to Dr. Deep Love. In immersion, you know? Come on. What do you say, Paul?
Sounds like a porno movie name, so I think we better not do that. How about just, I'm here to help. I'm a helper guy. I'm happy to help people.
I know you are. And for those of you, too, that haven't seen Paul's 2011 TED Talk, it's really a marvelous piece of presentation. You can learn a lot in how he presents it. And I just found the findings very, very interesting. I will also have a link to that in our show notes. Paul, anywhere else we should send people to learn more about your good work?
Getimmersion.com and get the book. It just came out, brand new, hot off the presses. So I'd love to get the support. Immersion, the size of the extraordinary and the source of happiness.
Beautiful. Well, congratulations on your new book. And Paul, thank you so much for taking the time to be here with us right on the Business of Story.
You're awesome, Park. Thank you.
Oh, I know. Can I now run this interview through your process to see what the highs and lows are?
You know, I was tempted to start up a measurement, which takes about 20 seconds, and actually measure and tell you. But I thought, oh, no, I don't want to. Maybe I suck. Maybe I'm the worst guest ever you've ever had.
You are not. You are not. You're a great guest. And boy, I would love to see what our highs and lows of this interview are. Anyways, Paul, I really appreciate you being here. Thank you.
Thank you, Park.
And thank you all for listening to this edition. If you like what you heard, certainly share it with your colleagues, friends, family, bosses. If you're in the marketing sales world, boy, I don't know what would be a better tool to use than Paul's new Immersion SaaS product. And it's not even that new. They've been working on it, what, Paul, 5 years? Has it been out? 5 years they've been working on it. And so check it out if you have any doubt in your storytelling or you think you're doing the absolute best you can be, and you are at the moment. Don't be intuitive about what you believe the outcomes or the impact of that storytelling is. Check out the platform Immersion, getimmersion.com, and put it to the test. And you'll get some actual scientific feedback on how your stories are resonating with the world out there. I also like where Paul was talking about in his 5-step approach, where he was talking about you've got to hook them immediately. You have to have that ball in play, 15 seconds right up top. And as my avid listeners know, well, there's no better way to do that than with the and, but, therefore. Start. Get your thinking around that overall story arc by first setting up the setup problem resolution dynamic. Write that and, but, therefore statement. 1 to 2 sentences tops. And when you can get it down and can tell it between 10 to 14 seconds, it sets up that limbic brain and saying, oh, we've got something important here. It's the hook that drags them into your presentation. And then, as Paul has mentioned, then make sure that that presentation is built on a story arc from there. So you are going to transport your audience from their world into your world, triggering oxytocin, dopamine, cortisol, whatever, those other neurotransmitters, to light up the theater of the mind, become immensely memorable. But just don't do it by winging it. You know, go and take the test. Put it through the test and see how your storytelling is working for you. If I can help you with any of that, the story structure frameworks, then certainly come on over to businessofstory.com. Listen every week where we have amazing story artists right here for you every Monday, just like Paul. And until next Monday, remember that the most potent story you'll ever tell is the story you tell yourself. So make it a great one. Thanks so much for listening.